video is brought to you by Knowledge at the Australian School of Business.
Many of us depend on financial planners for our future well-being, for everything from superannuations to trusts to even trying to reduce our annual tax bill. AMP has introduced a new academic alignment with UNSW, which allows students to gain credit towards a graduate diploma degree or master's qualification in financial planning at the Australian School of Business. It comes as the financial planning landscape has changed. The government has now changed the rules with the introduction of the Future of Financial Advice Reform Act. It changes everything from the way fees are charged to the way financial planners interact with clients. To analyse those changes, I'm here to talk to Tim Steele. He's the director of AMP Horizons Academy. So I've really noticed that there's been a move to in financial planning to treating it as a profession rather than a trade. Why is this?
Oh, look, I think the profession or the industry has been on a slow march towards achieving the true status of a profession for some time. If I could take you back a few years, AMP is a 160 plus year old company and started as a mutual insurance company, and a lot of the wealth management industry in Australia started the same way. And so we've been moving from what was a very product focused industry to what is now becoming a very advice focused profession, and appropriately so. Consumers are demanding more of financial planners, and that's important. And we're seeing a continuing shift from that perspective to looking at how we might be able to raise the profile of financial planning in the minds of consumers to help establish a greater level of trust, respect, and understanding of how financial planning can make a difference in their lives.
And as you were saying earlier about this change towards treating the profession as a profession rather than a trade, there's also been a move to introduce minimum education standards. Do you welcome this?
I think education standards, like any profession, are critical in the minds of consumers to give them confidence that they're going to get quality advice. Any other profession you might think about, be it the obvious ones of perhaps a lawyer or a doctor, you would be concerned in going to see either a lawyer or a doctor if you didn't think that they had at least an undergraduate degree. And whilst that alone doesn't build confidence or trust, it is an important pillar, I think, in an industry being regarded as a profession, is having higher minimum education standards so that we've got, and we're competing for viably, the best and brightest minds to consider a career in financial planning, in part because they're attracted to the education that they would expect in joining a profession.
And Tim, there's also a suggestion that we ought to have external assessment for financial planners. Do you welcome this, and indeed, how would it work?
Our financial planners at AMP have a minimum of 40 CPD points that they need to achieve every year in order to be part of our licensee structure. And I think that, again, is critical. Continuous learning and a commitment to upgrading your skills as the world continues to change is a really important part of a profession. And again, driven off the back of consumer expectations, if you were sitting across the table from a financial planner, you would expect that their knowledge would be relevant and current to today's world, to today's products and today's regulatory structures. So we, again, strongly encourage and support that there'd be ongoing requirements for continuous education, given that that's a hallmark of other professions.
But entrants into the profession now have also had to deal with the changes introduced by the Future of Financial Advice Reform Act. How do you respond to those changes? Are they welcome?
Look, I think in general terms they are, and I think the intent around FOFA, as it's known within the industry and profession, fundamentally is about increasing, I think, the standards and the quality of advice that consumers receive to ensure there's clear transparency between a planner and a client as to what they're getting and what they're paying for, and to increase, I think, the access to financial advice. For those who are serious about joining a profession, we believe that the changes that are coming through from FOFA in fact only serve to make the profession even more attractive to those types of people. They want to operate in that type of world, given where they can see the profession is headed, where there's, again, fee for service and a world of transparency and clear quality of advice articulated to clients.
And financial planning has often been seen as a male-dominated profession. And now, there are, of course, some female financial planners out there. Is there a push to encourage more women to take it up?
I think part of the challenge as to why we haven't seen more women in the profession is exactly the point that you raised in your question, which is it has been perceived to be a male-dominated industry for so long. And so it's not necessarily on that grounds, therefore, perceived to be particularly attractive. And so we need to try to smash that paradigm and make it clear that, in fact, for the right people, men or women, but in this case, think about women, for the right women, it can be an incredibly rewarding, fulfilling career that enables them to have the flexibility that may be important to them to balance any other priorities they have in their life. And for us, we've been able to create a new program called Horizons Academy Flex Program. And that has been aimed at trying to provide a flexible entry point to the profession for men and women, but again, particularly targeted at women who have an interest in financial planning but aren't able to make a full-time commitment to joining the profession. Some of the other challenges we've got beyond flexibility is, I think, breaking this perception that financial planning is about selling a product. And that's a key, I think, expectation or perception that we need to work to solve. So I think as we've moved from a product to an advice or relationship-based profession, it's far more attractive as opposed to the perception of the old world where they're selling a product to someone.
How do you see the profession going forward?
Well, look, we're incredibly optimistic and excited about where the profession's headed. And if you start to sort of project forward 5, 10, 15, 20 years, it's incredibly exciting to think that we're going to get to a point where we believe, ultimately, new entrants to the profession will actually have degrees in financial planning, again, aligned to other professions, where there will be a clear understanding in community and society around the value that financial planners can add in helping people achieve their financial needs and the broader impact that that has on society. And that's a really wonderful point for us to potentially get to as a profession, and again, with great pride, the important role that financial planners are going to play in continuing to make that change in Australia.
Tim Steele from AMP Horizons, thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Julian.
For more business news and analysis from Knowledge at the Australian School of Business, please visit knowledge.asb.unsw.edu.au.